Alright, hello everyone, welcome back to Suikoden 2. I am SIMSteven, also known as Mr. Fenrel. And today we're going to check out the aftermath of our battle with Luca Blight. In game, a week has passed, and Riou fainted after the fight with Luca himself because Riou put him out himself out there more than any other fighter, so he is our true leader, and he's no slacker when it comes to the fighting himself. He doesn't let everyone else do the fighting for him. In fact, he's on the front lines all the time. But either way, we're doing a Richmond investigation. It looks like we're doing Kiba. General Kiba's first battle was the defense of Fort Redo. He's led a small force of 100 men and managed to repulse 3,000 hardened state veterans. Impressive! Alright, well, we're gonna go back over to investigate Kiba again. Looks like we're on his last secret. So we're just gonna have him do that. And mostly we're gonna be doing side quests today, as per usual. I believe there are a bunch more recruits now to get, because defeating Luca Blight is no small feat. It looks like we've got, we'll see here in the main hall, looks like there won't be any battles for a while, and if Apple and the others just do their part, war might be over soon. Hey, Riou, let's go for a walk, okay? Ever since we escaped from the mutants, we haven't had any free time. I want to look around in South Window in Couscous Town. Alright, so, looks like we got a few places to go take a look at. I do believe there are a few recruits out there for us to get in the nearby area. Now that the Highland troops, all under Luca Blight's command, have dispersed and gone back to Highland for the time being. And there's two guys right there. I think that's the next event that we need to do. To continue with the story, but for now, I am going to talk to this gal here in the Couscous Inn. What is your business? Join our group, of course. Don't mean to join your group, but I could be of any use to you. That's not true, really. Well, just one thing. What? Just one thing. You can keep up with my dancing, I'll join you. Is that okay? Okay, I'll do it. Like Mina before in the first game, looks like we got ourselves a dancing girl to join our army. Anyway, she's gotta get ready and she'll be right back after this black screen transition. But anyway, wow, that's kind of a impressive costume change. Anyway, well, are you ready to start? Let's dance. So, I believe this is simply a rhythm game or a quick time event, something like that. Basically, all you gotta do is push the buttons in sequence, and you can listen to the explanation, but I'm pretty sure I know what to do here, so we'll let her go first and watch carefully how I do it, or how she does it. So, I think... Yeah, it does tell you what button you need to press, so I'm gonna have to do some concentration here. Triangle, square, circle, X. Triangle, X, circle, square. Alright, so I don't think we need to do it in rhythm. I think all we have to do is just press them in order. But we'll try to do it in rhythm. So... So I tried to go along with her clapping there. And after we're done, we just let it sit there for a sec. And fist pump. We did it! Hoo-hoo-hoo, that was fun. Thank you, Riou. Well, a promise is a promise. I'll join up with you now. And I believe she's either got split personalities or what, but once she's on stage, she's no longer the quiet and shy little village girl here, but she's... kind of a maniac on stage if you actually see her do some dances. So, I've kind of been going back here quite a bit throughout the course of the game. And I knew she would be showing up sooner or later, but apparently you need to beat Luca to get the trigger. Or perhaps I needed to just, I just needed to get a few more recruits. I'm not entirely sure if that was the case, but either way, where is it? I'm pretty sure there's someone here. Yes. This guy in the bright red flashy outfit here is our next guy. But yeah, I've been checking to see if Kieran would come up. And I even checked right before he went to Torin, but she wasn't there either. The only recruits I think we're kind of missing at this point are Ada and the two large monsters. So, we have less stars than I usually do at this point in time of the game when I'm playing through. But I don't think that was a star required. I think it was just a story requirement. But yeah, there's a lot of people for us to recruit now in the old towns. Like this guy here, Killey. I'm Killey. I'm following the trail of the Sindar. Have you heard any rumors about them? Alex knows a lot about the Sindar runes. Alex. Oh yeah, that guy from the inn. Thanks. I owe you one. Well, Alex is a member of our army. And we're not gonna let that guy just go and walk up to Alex and hassle him too much, but I do believe... No, there's not a person over there. Eventually we'll be getting a recruit that's standing over here, but that person isn't here just yet. And this guy, we still have to wait on. He's kind of been standing there this whole time, kind of, he's this great priest, as he says so himself. But, yeah, there's nothing you can do with him until much later in the game. Either way, I believe that's all the recruits we can get for now. Very short list. Well, actually, we haven't finished up Killey here, but now that we've told him, you know, Alex did some little Sindar ruins searching back when we were staying at the White Deer Inn very early in the game. But now that he's here as a member of our army, he's like, "Who are you?" "You used to run an inn called the White Deer Inn." Well, actually, it was Hilda that ran them in. "You opened the gate to the Sindar ruins, right? Why would you do that?" I think that was a mistranslation. He asked, "Why would you do that?" And I can actually move the text box forward. The game did that automatically. "Alex!" Well, I don't know why Alex would say, "Why would you do that?" I think that was supposed to be Killey's line.
"What are you doing to my dad?"
"What did you find in the ruins? Tell me or I'll kill you."
"His life? I won't let you do that. I won't let you hurt Alex."
"Dad!"
And we got a lot of people coming in because of this commotion that this guy is stirring up.
"I'll ask you again. What did you find in the Sindar ruins?" "If you don't tell me..."
Let's help and see what's going on here. Wait a minute, everybody. I don't know what you want to hear, but the treasure of the Sindar ruins is right in front of your eyes. His family, of course, if you remember the scenario. Hilda fell ill as soon as we were leaving, but we got the healing herbs from the Sindar ruins, and he still keeps his family thanks to those healing herbs. "This is the treasure I found. You got a problem with that?"
"Your words, they have the ring of truth in them.
How would you know?"
"I'm sorry, I'm so rude. Forgive me. Looks like you've got some good friends."
I don't know what his bulk is, but he apparently is very interested in what the Sindar have to offer, or whatever they're hiding. In order to finish the scenario here, all we gotta do is go back to South Window, back to where we originally found him. I don't know what he's doing, nosing around in the business of the Sindar. I probably could take a minute to explain a little bit about them. I don't know everything about the Sindar, and I believe more gets explained, I think, in Suikoden 5? I know there's also a ruin in Suikoden 3, but not much gets explained about the Sindar in Suikoden 3. But I believe much of the story picks up in Suikoden 5, but more about Lorelei and Killey himself. because I believe those two are both very interested in Sindar runes. And, well, that's a story for another day, pretty much. But the whole Sindar story, which I believe comes in Suikoden 5, is based on Suikoden 2, because the main story writer, the main creative minds behind the Suikoden series, left pretty much near the end of Suikoden 3's development. And they actually made a story when they continued the franchise in Suikoden 5, and they derived it from this game, if I remember right. So, anyways, Killey here, I don't know what his deal is once again. He's still being kind of mysterious, but we want to ask him, why did you do that? Can't say much, but the relics that were left by the Sindar should not fall into the hands of normal men. You can relax. That man wasn't lying. I won't go anywhere near there anymore. You want something? Join us? Friend? Stop. Besides, that's not something I would do. You want something? Pester him! There's no reason for me to get involved in your war. Why not? You look like you're at least strong enough to fight. So, asking three times must be the charm. When I was out asking for the runes for the Sindar, a lot of people told me about you. Seems I was wrong about you. That will be fine. But if I come across any clues about the Sindar, I want out. Well, we're not asking you to stay for forever, but he is a very strong fighter. Back a long time ago, I wrote a guide. not a full walkthrough for this game, but I did write kind of a database on character stats. I gave this guy a fairly average slash kind of low rating. But that at the time I wrote the guide, I actually didn't know a whole lot about this trick with a three rune setup. It's a very specific setup. Lets you do a lot of damage, but this guy is one of the best guys for that setup. It's considered to be actually a very cheap rune setup, but I don't know if I'm actually going to do it for anything major in the story. I kind of want to avoid cheap setups, and, well, here's coming from this guy here, who's used Amused Matilda Border Gate glitch to level up like 20 or 30 levels higher than I was supposed to be at the time of the game. But now I'm going to try and play this kind of straight up at this point in time. And I'm not sure if I'm going to use this rune setup, but I might actually put it on here and show you just how good of a rune setup it is. And he's one of the few people that can use three runes freely without any fixed rune slots, and that makes him one of the best candidates for it. Anyways, he's a lucky man. I mean, many got involved with Sindar and found something so valuable. So, from what little I know, because I did read up a little bit about the Sindar because I was curious about them, and nothing really gets explained about the Sindar in the first three games, but I did read some information about them that came from, like, the later games that I haven't played yet. But the Sindar were a nomadic people who, I believe the leader of the Sindar bore the true rune of change. I believe that's what it's called. But they moved from place to place, and they were very skilled in the arts of runes. In fact, they learned how to manipulate true runes better than any other people in the world. But at some point in time in history, they vanished completely. And all that's left are the ruins of all the places they traveled from throughout the course of the years that they were just a tribe of people and so on and so forth. So, and the powers were so great and their knowledge of ruins was so great that a lot of the ruins that they left behind have relics of sorts. And said relics are relics of great power in the fact that they can actually manipulate the true ruins themselves. Typically, when a true rune is bound to a person, like, say, Riou or Joey, or to someone like Tyr, or maybe some of the other true runes users we met throughout the course of the game, basically, when a true rune chooses a host, that rune is stuck to them. They can't remove it without willfully getting involved with whatever the Shroon wants, because the Shroons have a mind of their own and a will of their own. And I skipped over what Kiva's message was. But yeah, unless the Shroon wills it, they will not typically go from one mess to another. But there are special cases, perhaps, if the Shroon themselves want it to happen. So, for example, when Ted gave the Shroon to Tyr in the first game, it's probably because Ted was so gravely injured and that the Shroon wanted to transfer itself onto Tyr or something like that. But either way, we got Kiva's vial here. Swore fealty to Garrus Blight, but when Garrus was killed by some Luca, he came to us. He's a pretty complex guy. I guess he's loyal to the king more than he is to Luca. But either way, I probably could talk more about that as well. Just the relationship with the Blights and how things have been going with the story and all that. And I did not send Richmond off. But yeah, to continue the story about the Sindar, one big deal about the Sindar is they had the ability to manipulate Shroon. So what I was going with the story there is that normally you can't remove a Shroon. Well, the Sindar discovered a technique where they can actually forcibly remove a Shroon from a person against the Shroon's own will. And we're talking about the very things that make up the fabric of this world, which those are the 27 Shroons. And all elements of nature in the known world are governed by the Shroons. So being able to put yourself above the Shroons, it's almost like you have, you know, technology or knowledge of magic that's greater than the Shroons themselves, if you can manipulate Shroons in that way. So I believe that's what we need to do, and well, I guess that's all I really need to talk about with the Sindar themselves. I probably want to go into a conversation about Kiva, Luca, Agares, especially Joey, because of all the fighting we've done to get us up to this point, and all the kind of, I just kind of summarize a little bit about where we're at in the story. But first and foremost, I want to do a little mini game here. Now that we recruited Karen, you can actually do some dancing mini game here on the stage. So let's actually do this and show this off first and foremost before we go any farther. Hey, what? Okay, no. You want to dance with me? I guess she likes the attention. There she goes. She just kind of strips in front of you and it's like, oh. Sudden costume change. Oh, okay. Well, let's go to the stage. And I've noticed that she doesn't even have a facial portrait when she's in this form. Well, are you ready to start? Alright, so we're going to do this mini game really quick here. And I'm not going to do the whole thing, but I believe there are like 5 levels to this. And if you get them correct, she'll give you a prize. So we're going to do, I think, the same thing as what we did when we first recruited her. Triangle, square, circle, X. Triangle, X, circle, square. Okay, so this is round one. It's the same as before. Alright, and all we got to do is follow along. And I'm going to see if we can do this the first time and get a prize for it. Oh, I screwed up. Well, since I screwed up, I'm just gonna mash ones. Hey, there you go. I failed. I hit X twice in a row. Let's try again. And we'll do this right the next time. I want to actually show the kind of things you can get from her if you do it right. Alright, it's our turn. Let's try this again. And I'm not following along with the rhythm, but who cares? I don't think it really matters all that much. Either way, I believe if you do fairly well at this, she will actually give you Well, she takes off her little veil there, but... and she laughs at you. But either way, pretty good. Well, let's... Well, next let's try to dance a little longer. Alright, I believe... Yes, there we go. I believe next time we try this, we'll get another Karen item. But the Karen items are classified as antiques, and you can actually throw them in your bathhouse and decorate the bathhouse with the Karen antiques. So we'll actually show that off real quick. Because why not? What else have we got to do with antiques besides sell them? But the Karen antiques are unique in that there is only one of each in the game. So you can actually throw... Let's just put that right there where the dish is. Let's place this Chinese dish here. Let's place the other Chinese dish here. And the bonsai tree. Let's put that there and we'll do something else with the hex doll, since that's basically a cheapo item that's really a failure antique whenever you get them. But anywho, yeah. You can get, I think, 5 different Karen antiques, and you can throw them all in the bathhouse if you want. But I believe each round you do with Karen gets harder and harder. I believe what'll happen is there'll be extra steps to dance after this, and eventually they'll start throwing in other buttons like L1 and R1. And later on, I believe they'll also just remove the controller display entirely, and you have to do it by memory. So you have to know what each button does, and you have to follow along on screen. But either way, I want to do another restaurant cooking contest.